delegation. Oh, oh, oh. Don't think you need to settle for a substitute.
What is the source of conflict among you? What is the source of your disputes? Don't they come from your cravings that are at war in your own lives? Welcome to this service of worship. We're glad that you're with us. We have a few things that we want to note for you as we continue. First, what do you really want? I mean, we all want something, right? What that something is changes from time to time, as we all know. But really, as you think about your life as a whole, what do you want? And what are you willing to do to get it? What are you willing to compromise? What are you willing to give up? And should you want it? As you move forward through the week, reflecting not only on the scriptures that we're about to read and engage, think about that question. What do you want? And does it match up with what God wants for you? Because God is for you. Also, one of the things that we want here at the church is your help with some salt and pepper shakers. If you collect salt and pepper shakers, if you've got a pair that you just love, if you've got a pair that's just collecting dust on a shelf, maybe you've got some that you picked up on a vacation, whatever. We need to borrow them, and we need to borrow as many as we can get our hands on. They're going to become part of the worship display for next Sunday. So please bring them anytime before 5 p.m. Tuesday, this coming Tuesday, September the 21st. You may leave them on the table by the stage in the fellowship hall. You can leave them in the church office, or if you need to drop them off after hours, you can leave them in the vestibule of the sanctuary building. But please mark them with your name, and then you will be able to take them home after worship on the 26th. We will be careful with all of the treasures. But thank you in advance for your help with this project. Also, one of the ways that, of course, we help corporately is through giving and through our stewardship. And so with that in mind, please take a look at this appeal from one of the members of our administrative life committee.
Good day, everyone. I come before you to talk about stewardship at the Hawfields Presbyterian Church. Our stewardship is how we are able to sustain our church and continue to build, grow, and share. For the next few weeks, the administrative committee will be reminding us of our stewardship. At this time, I'd like to discuss stewardship through time and talents. Financial support is important, and it allows us to pay for those time and talents of others. But offering up your own time and talents gives a personal touch that only that individual can give, and that is oh so precious. Our talent can mean many things when it comes to serving God. The ability to show compassion, it comes easily for some people, but not so for others. This is an example of a God-given talent. Computer skills, physical strength, musical ability, these are all gifts that some are given and some are not. We need everyone. We all have God-given talents. The ability to drive a car can be used to serve God. Please take a moment to consider what you have to offer. The talents in this congregation are unique to us, and that's what makes us special. I can name a few things that you need to be involved with in order to be successful. Bereavement committee. We need bakers. We need compassionate and comforters. We need deliveries of church videos and meals to the in crowd. Putting a fresh message on the marquee sign every week. Help with scouting programs. Landscaping or general maintenance in the facility. Musical talent is always welcomed. The list goes on and on. But we need you. No matter how big or how small the task, we need you. I want to encourage everyone to share what God has given you. Please contact the members of the session for guidance on where your time and talents can serve God. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for all the blessings we receive each day. Thank you for all the talents we possess. Come into our hearts and guide us into the ways our talents can be serve you, Lord. In your glorious name we pray. Amen.
Another way that you can help is through a ministry of presence. Now, the very first thing in all of creation that God calls bad is loneliness. It is not good that the human is alone, God says. Loneliness, and especially its cousin, isolation, is a true source of a lot of current ills. And we all have the ability to fulfill God's vision for a remedy. So reach out. Make a call on someone on the prayer list, especially if you don't know them. Write a letter or a card. Send that email. And yes, definitely text your sentiments and prayer and support. And if you're not sure about a number, call the church office for help. You can really visit. Stand in the driveway, in the doorway, the entryways. Knock on the door, ring the bell, bring and accept hospitality. But especially personally, see to it that at least one person knows that they are not alone because of you this week and in the weeks to come. And if you don't know what to say, just say your name, that you're a part of the church and that you're praying. God's Spirit will take care of the rest and of you. Ways that you can further help, you can get ideas about from the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance website. This is an important arm of our ministry, arm of our denomination. And whether you're talking about relief for hurricane victims, earthquake victims, refugees, COVID victims here at home, folks who are sick and shut in, their website has great ideas on connecting your real help with real needs. So please do pay attention to the website that's on your screen and access it. Currently, we're about to announce a way that you can help directly for relief with some Hurricane Ida victims through the making of health kits. And you'll get a little bit more information about that as the week progresses. But again, do visit the site and think through how to connect your help with folks who really, really need it. Now, with these things in mind, let us take a deep breath, silence your devices, and let us continue in worship. Let us be called to worship. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God put us in charge of watching over them. God gave us the law, and God put us in charge of keeping it. God sent Jesus into our midst with the gospel, and God put us in charge of sharing it. But we do well to remember who set all of this in motion. Let us sing together.
Thank you.
You know, God entrusts so much to us, and yet we frequently act untrustworthy. But we trust in God's grace, and that's why we can confess our sin before God and each other. So let's pray. Holy God, wonder of wonders, why in the world do you have such faith in us? Why would you share dominion over the earth? Why would you share your law with us? Why would you share your spirit with us? Why would you risk sending Jesus to us, giving the gospel to us? Why do you believe so much in us when it is clear we do not believe in you as much? But we're glad you do. We're glad your mercies are everlasting, and your word will not return to you empty. Forgive us when we forget your trust. In the great name of Jesus Christ, we pray this together. Thank you for listening, God. Amen. So hear the good news of God's promise. In Joel, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. So to understand God's word, we really do need God's help. So we ask for it. Let's join together in the prayer for illumination. Holy God, let there be no mistake. We want to hear from you. As the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, let us be open to what your spirit directs and have the courage and will to act. Amen. Our scripture readings come to us from two places this weekend, beginning with James chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible, Common English translation of the Bible. The writer gives us an admonishment to humility. Listen for the word of God to us all. What is the source of conflict among you? What is the source of your disputes? Don't they come from your cravings that are at war in your own lives? You long for something you don't have, so you commit murder. You are jealous of something you can't get, so you struggle and fight. You don't have because you don't ask. You ask and don't have because you ask with evil intentions to waste it on your own cravings. You unfaithful people. Don't you know that friendship with the world means hostility toward God? So whoever wants to be the world's friend becomes God's enemy. Or do you suppose that scripture is meaningless? Doesn't God long for our faithfulness in the life he has given to us? But he gives us more grace. That is why it says God stands against the proud, but favors the humble. Therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will run away from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Our second reading comes to us from the Gospel according to Mark. This is chapter 9, verses 30 through 37. I will again be reading from the Common English Bible. Here, Jesus encourages us to consider greatness requires humility. Listen further for the word of God to us all. From there, Jesus and his followers went through Galilee, but he didn't want anyone to know it. This was because he was teaching his disciples. The human one will be delivered into human hands. They will kill him. 3 days after he is killed, he will rise up. But they didn't understand this kind of talk, and they were afraid to ask him. They entered Capernaum. When they had come into the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about during the journey?" They didn't respond, since on the way, they had been debating with each other about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, Whoever wants to be first must be least of all and the servant of all. Jesus reached for a little child, placed him among the 12, and embraced him. Then he said, whoever welcomes one of these children in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me isn't actually welcoming me, but rather the one who sent me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So at this point, please do pause the video after you get the instructions for the children's sermon if you've got folks in your household for whom this applies. Now, once you're done, you can resume, or if you don't have children in your household, you can skip over this part to the sermon. I have to admit, I love cop shows. I really do. I especially love watching this concept play out. Most often, the police are asking questions during the interrogation to which they already know the answer. And where were you on the night in question? Well, yeah, I'm pretty sure it was with my friend Eddie. Well, then why is Eddie saying that he never saw you? Oh. I mean, I love it, right? And the thing is, we have a ridiculously rich history of this kind of thing with God. Take the Garden of Eden scene in Genesis 3, for instance. There they are, Adam and Eve, after being told not to eat the fruit, and wham, literally caught with no pants. So what's their master plan? Let's try and hide from the creator of the universe and all that we see around us, including ourselves. That was their plan. Yeah, that should work. But then what they did next was even more unbelievable. They started the blaming thing, trying to pass off responsibility. I mean, there's Adam saying, well, you know, this woman that you gave me, God, is the one who gave me fruit. And then Eve is like, well, the snake talked me into it. And the snake is like, I mean, in the end, all of them simply had to face up to the consequences of their choices. It wasn't punishment. It was consequence. God asked Cain in Genesis chapter 4, where is your brother Abel? Now, do you think that Cain and Abel's parents taught Cain, you know, that you really can't trick God? We've already been through all that. Probably. But there he is making the same mistake that his parents made in almost the same way. He tries to pass off responsibility. He says, am I my brother's guardian? But in the end, he had to face the consequences of his choice to kill his own brother. You know, Abraham blames the wife. Moses blames the people. Jacob and Laban blame each other. Jezebel blames Elijah the prophet. Jeremiah the prophet blames God. Jonah blames God's compassion. King David couldn't even see how far he had fallen until he had tried to get self-righteous. I mean, it's a good thing that we're so much more enlightened nowadays, right? Yeah, right. And here, in the gospel story, the disciples find themselves in the historical, in fine historical traditional company. First, they decide that rather than ask Jesus to further explain or clarify the whole cross and death thing, they'll just act like they understand. You know, nobody does that nowadays, right? And then they argue about who's the greatest. I mean, whatever seemed like an okay thing to do at the time suddenly looked bad under gentle, divine scrutiny. Jesus asks a simple question to which he already knows the answer. And of course, the disciples try to dodge responsibility, even though they clearly care about the answer. And again, you know, sarcasm aside, why do we do this still? Why? And, you know, look, I'm giving the disciples a hard time, but let's be honest, this is a tough question. I mean, just look at the thoughtful and beautiful responses that you all provided to the question, what does it take to be a great leader? You said honesty, integrity, good communication skills, motivation, accountability, respect, empathy, empathetic listening, being soul-oriented, delegation, selflessness, being encouraging, the ability to see, understand, and respect the perspective of others, humility and compassion, the intuition to know how to keep the group motivated, sincerity, the ability to see the bigger picture, just to name a few. And these are all wonderful and admirable. And considering the people who shared these views, they all know something about the subject because everybody who responded are all leaders, elders, superintendents, department heads, teachers, heads of household, people who have wielded influence and have borne the consequences of decisions and watched their effects on others. And none of them are wrong. A good leader should indeed embody all of those things. And of the submissions made, do you know that listening was the number one quality name, with integrity being a very close second? Which I think is a reflection of our times, right? Again, perfect answers. But can you imagine if our elected leadership actually did any of the things that you all named? But there was only one response that really matched up with God's answer as we find it. Humility. Now, let's be clear. A humble leader is great, but if they can't listen or delegate or don't have integrity or go around discouraging people all the time, then they aren't going to be good leaders. But what Jesus is getting at here is a supremely important, necessary quality for true faith and for true greatness. And it comes from an important place. The letter of James cuts right to the heart of what's wrong with the disciples' conversation, and frankly, with a lot of our conversations also. And it tells from the very opening question of the passage. What is the source of conflict among you? What is the source of your disputes? Don't they come from your cravings that are at war in your own lives? I mean, think of the conflicts of which you've been a part. Think of the ones which we've been a part of as a church, as a town, as a country, as a state, as a nation, as a human race. The disciples were covering their spiritual bases, ironically, to determine who was actually closest to Jesus. The Roman Empire, you know, they looked to make Christians the scapegoat for their complete collapse as a nation. The Revolutionary War came down to our desire to live self-sovereign apart from the interests, the pernicious interests of the English crown. Manifest destiny was the justification for the Trail of Tears. The Civil War was at its heart an economic dispute surrounding the financial power that slavery represented. The Nazi Party convinced the German nation, an entire nation of people, to blame Jews, socialists, trade unionists, minorities, and the infirmed for the economic ravages in their country. And do you want to know why there's so much conflict in our country today? Follow the money. Do you want to know why our world feels like it's in perpetual conflict? Follow the money. And as we identify with the sins that James names for us, follow our economic interests. I mean, really, it is all over this letter. But before we get into the solution that James offers to all of these ills, historical, self-imposed, and otherwise, let's part company with a real huge misinterpretation of verse 4. Don't you know that friendship with the world means hostility toward God? So whoever wants to become the world wants to be the world's friend becomes God's enemy. Y'all, I've watched in real time preachers and other leaders take these words and twist them into a justification for isolation and for bewilderingly brutal interactions. The idea being that religious purity is the goal of God for humankind. Well, it's not the vision of James, nor of this passage in particular. James is pressing toward a much more powerful dream. I mean, you have to ignore almost the entire letter to take the view that we're supposed to keep ourselves separate from those that we think of as being the world, whatever that means to you or me. Thus, verse 6 says it better than anything. But God gives us more grace. This is why it says, God stands against the proud, but favors the humble. You see, it's not exactly a new idea. In fact, this idea is ancient. It comes to us from creation itself. All we have, all we could ever want, all we could even think we possess comes from God. God gives us life. God gives us grace. God comes near to us when we come near to God. For all the power we think we have over creation, over others, even over ourselves, it was all a gift from the only one who's really holding the power. Now, at this point, do pause the video and take a moment to think or to talk with the folks viewing with you about how, about the leaders that you respect. Just name them. And then, how many of them exhibited this quality of humility as God describes it? How did they show it? So when God comes to question us, how will we answer? When God comes to confront us, what will our plan be? Will we try to change the subject, deny responsibility, act as though we don't know or understand? Will we embrace the standard God presents to us? God didn't come to us as the son of Herod, the king, but of Mary, a teenage girl. God didn't elevate the disciples to power, but wash their feet. God didn't conquer the Roman Empire or us through force, but allowed Jesus to die. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8 crystallizes this point for us. Adopt the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. Though he was in the form of God, he did not consider being equal with God something to exploit. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a slave and by becoming like human beings. When he found himself in the form of a human, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. In the end, All of us who claim to be people of faith are leaders. We're the ones who become the hands and feet of God. We are the ones who become the eyes and the ears of Christ for others. We are the ones who become the arms of welcome of the very Spirit of God. We are the ones whom God put in charge of the doors. Doors to compassion. Doors to listening. Doors to hope. Doors to honesty, integrity, communication, motivation, empathy, respect, delegation, selflessness, encouragement, perspective, intuition, sincerity, doors, y'all, to greatness, all opened by hands that God crafted. Yours, mine, ours. You know, in case it wasn't already clear, God expects greatness from all of us. It just takes humility to get there. In the name of the one who is counting on us. Amen. Let us reflect and respond and sing together.
Everybody falls sometimes, gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes, make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache, you think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now.
Me.
So we give because God's own Spirit has been given to us. And so that same spirit of generosity must be given from us, reflected in what we say, what we do, and how we give. So let us do so joyfully.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest waters and deepest pain, wouldn't trade it for anything. My brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always change. Standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness, and I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them
our gifts offered in earnest. Multiply them according to your purposes so that they may serve your ends. And in the process, make us all a part of the blessing you mean for the world. Amen.
As we enter into this time of prayer, let me admit and encourage you to some reality. First, this is a recording. So does that count for saying that we are praying together? Does that really add up to us praying together as a church? Well, the answer to that, the straightforward answer to that is yes. Now, I will own that it might not feel that way. And maybe even in your mind, it might not be that way. But I assure you that as you pray, as I pray, as we pray, at our various times, various places, and various ways, God hears them all. And most importantly, God responds to them all. So be faithful in your prayers. Pray well. and let us pray together. Lord God, we give you thanks for another day. Thanks for another opportunity to see you at work in the world and to see your invitation for us to be a part of what you are doing. Thank you for the trust that you engender with us and that you have placed with us. Help us live into that. Help us live up to that. Help us set aside whatever doubts and guilt and whatever other obstacles we might be feeling and embrace the destiny you place before us. Let us indeed be a part of changing the world, and let it begin with our humility toward you. Help us to acknowledge and remember that you indeed have given us everything. Our abilities, our money, our brains, our ability to believe, our capacity to have faith. You've given us love and invited us to share it. Again, Lord God, help us live into these things. We also acknowledge that the world around us is hard. The world around us indeed has not been our friend, even as we embrace some of the things that the world presents to us. Help us to tell the difference. And in embracing you, to be sure to continue to seek to embrace one another, even when it is difficult, even when it seems possible. For this reason, O God, we pray for our world, and not just an end to the pandemic, an end to the virus. We ask for an end to the conflicts. We do ask for peace. We do ask that everyone would have enough, and that we would eventually learn, really learn how to share. Help this come from an earnest place, O God, and transform our thinking and our ways of regarding each other. Thank you for the gifts that you have placed in our midst. Thank you for the families, for the skills, for the experiences. Thank you for the perspectives. And thank you for the opportunities to ministry. With this in mind, O God, we do lift up those people who were victims of the hurricanes, including Ida and Nicholas. We pray for the people who are yet victims of the fires that continue out west, the earthquakes that have taken place in Haiti and in Southern California, those yet affected by the withdrawal from Afghanistan. Lord God, all those families who've experienced such loss and such illness, not just through COVID, but through so many other things, cancer, accidents, even conspicuous interactions. Lord God, we ask you to intervene in them all. And where we feel your urging to be your hands and feet, your eyes and ears, even your mouth, that we would give in and we would do so. Again, thank you for the trust that you place with us, and help us live into it. We pray this in the great name of Jesus Christ, who showed us the way, who showed us how, and who trusted us to follow, even in the way that he prayed, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us say together our benediction. In case it wasn't already clear, God expects greatness from all of us. It just takes humility to get there. Get up, take heart. Jesus is still calling you. Go in peace. Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.